All right, today we are diving deep into one of the absolute cornerstones of economics, the producer's supply curve. We're going to figure out how any business, whether it's a small farm or a huge tech company, decides exactly how much stuff to put on the market. Let's get right into it. So, let's just start by putting you in the driver's seat for a second. Seriously, if you were the one making and selling something, what goes through your head? How do you decide day to day if you're going to sell a little or a lot? This is the core question that every single producer has to answer. And yeah, that question is exactly where we're going to start. We'll use a really simple, down-to-earth example that I think is going to make this whole thing just click. Okay, picture this. You're a tomato farmer. You've worked hard, you've got a truck full of beautiful tomatoes. You get to the market, you check the board, and the price for tomatoes is low today. Ugh, what do you do? Your gut says to hold back, right? You don't want to sell everything for a bargain basement price. But what if the price was crazy high? Well, then you'd be trying to sell every last tomato you've got. So, here's the key. Your decision isn't just about what the market is willing to pay. It's all about how that price compares to your cost. And not just any cost. It's about how much it costs you to produce that very next tomato. This one little idea is the key to unlocking this entire concept. So let's see how that one idea actually lets us build the supply curve. We're literally going to construct this thing from the ground up, starting with that simple concept of the cost for one more. You know, in economics, there's a name for this. It's called marginal cost, or MC for short. It's just the change in your total costs when you decide to produce one more widget, one more tomato, one more anything. Producers are always thinking on the margin, asking, okay, if I make just one more of these, what's it going to cost me? So how do we get from that thought process to a line on a graph? Well, it's actually a pretty simple three-step process. First, you keep track of your output. Second, you figure out the marginal cost for each new unit or batch of units. And third, you just plot those two numbers against each other, quantity and marginal cost. So let's look at some real numbers. To get to your 100th tomato, the marginal cost was $10. But to push production up to 180, your cost for those extra units went up to $12. Maybe you had to run your equipment longer or buy more fertilizer. By the time you get to 250, that marginal cost is up to 15. See the pattern? As you produce more, it often gets more expensive to produce each additional unit. Now, if you take those points from our table and you throw them onto a graph with quantity on the bottom and costs going up the side, you'll get a line that slopes up and to the right. That line, right there, is your marginal cost curve. It's a picture that shows, hey, the more I make, the more it costs to make the next one. And this right here, this is the big reveal, the most important takeaway. A producer's marginal cost curve is their supply curve. They are one in the same. And why? Well, it's simple. A smart producer is only willing to sell one more unit if the market price is at least as high as what it costs them to make it. The cost dictates the supply. It's that direct. Okay, so we've built our supply curve. Now what? How do businesses actually use it? Well, this next part is all about how producers react to the market as prices change all the time. First, we got to get a really critical distinction down. There are two and only two ways supply can change. You can have a movement along the curve, which is just a reaction to a price change, or you can have a shift of the curve, which is something much bigger. It's when the fundamental economics of the business change. Let's tackle movement first. Let's go back to our tomato farmer. Remember, their marginal cost to produce 100 tomatoes was $10. Now, imagine the morning news comes out and suddenly the market price for tomatoes jumps from $10 up to $12. So since the price is now $12, it's suddenly profitable for the farmer to produce more. They'll keep increasing production right up to the point where their marginal cost equals that new price, which on our chart is at 180 units. See what happened? They didn't change their business. They just reacted to the market by moving from point A to point B on their existing supply curve. But what happens when it's not the market price that changes, but the actual cost of doing business? Well, that's when we don't just move along the curve. The whole curve itself picks up and moves. So imagine the price of fertilizer doubles overnight. Or maybe a new law means you have to pay all your workers more. Now, your marginal cost to produce at every single level is higher than it was yesterday. This forces your entire supply curve to shift over to the left, which means a decrease in supply. And what that means in the real world is that even if the market price is still $10, you're not selling 100 tomatoes anymore. No way. Your costs are too high. At that same price, you're now going to offer a smaller quantity. Now, on the flip side, what if something makes it cheaper to produce? You know, maybe raw materials get less expensive. But the big one, the real game changer here, is technology. Think about a new harvesting machine that's way more efficient. That slashes your marginal costs all across the board. This kind of technological leap causes the entire supply curve to shift to the right, which represents a big increase in supply. Now, at that same market price of $10, you're not just willing to sell 100 tomatoes, you're happy to sell way more because it's just gotten that much cheaper to produce them. Okay, so we've built the curve, we've moved along it, we've shifted the whole thing. Let's zoom out for a second and talk about why this is such a powerful idea. Why does this matter?
The thing is, the supply curve isn't just some abstract drawing in a textbook. It's basically a map of a producer's brain. It's a clear, predictable model for how any business is going to react to the constant chaos of market prices and production costs.
And this same logic, it's everywhere. It explains why a farmer plants more corn when corn prices are high. It explains why a car factory can suddenly churn out more vehicles for the same price after they install a new set of robots. It's a truly universal principle. So, I'll just leave you with this to chew on. We live in an era where technology is constantly improving, constantly making it cheaper to produce things, which is constantly pushing all of these supply curves to the right. So what does that mean for the future, for the availability and the price of everything we rely on? It's a pretty powerful question to think about. Thanks for tuning in.